Brother Ervin would say, you receive the glory and honor and praise for it all. In Jesus' name.
If I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal ken, and I'm sure that He'd grant. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll.
Sing that song like Alan Jackson. My neighbor Ervin would be pleased. This time I'm going to have Brother Timmy Wood to come up and read a letter from Brother Samuel. Thank you all for being here today. I know it means a great deal to the family, and it will mean a great deal to Mr. Ervin as well. Most of you already know me, but for those who don't know me, my name is Timmy Wood. I am Ervin's son-in-law, and not to brag, but he did tell me once that I was his favorite son-in-law. He followed that up by reminding me that I was his only son-in-law, but still I took it as a great compliment. I will apologize for one thing in advance. You will hear the words Mr. Ervin multiple times throughout this eulogy. I try to avoid being repetitive, but even now, this is the only way I feel comfortable referring to him. I had the privilege of being part of this family for 20 plus years. I've had the privilege of being part of this family for 20 plus years. And that allowed me access to one of the greatest men I have ever known, Mr. Robert Ervin Dunn. I was honored to be asked to speak today, But as I began putting my thoughts together, I realized that this would be much more difficult than I had anticipated. Words cannot do someone like Mr. Ervin justice. You almost had to see him in action. He seemed larger than life to me, and in many respects he was. There was no way you could be around him for any length of time and not realize that this man was of a different breed. He was a body in constant motion, and when he did stop to rest, you could tell his mind was still going, still working. He was a patriot who loved his country dearly and served for a time in the military. He was a natural born leader that was intentional with his words and his time. He could be tough if needed, but at his core beat a tender heart that felt compassion for his fellow man. He loved his church family here at Manor Chapel and served in every capacity asked of him over the years, from Sunday school teacher to chairman of the official board. He was a man who was passionate about life, and he lived it to the fullest. Everything he undertook, he did so with great care and pride. No detail was left unattended. No corner was cut. He was a farmer that plowed deep and straight. He put a high value on keeping all his equipment clean and maintained and producing a quality crop for his customers. He was organized. He had a place for everything, and everything was in its place. And if it wasn't, it was because Scott or Rodney had moved it. Mr. Ervin's talents ran much deeper than farming, however. He was an engineer who could fix most any piece of equipment that was in need of repair. And if it couldn't be fixed, he very well might fabricate something that could work in its place. He built ballet bars and props for Christy to use at her dance studio that can only be described as works of art. He created these things with no blueprint and very little instruction. He just saw it in his mind's eye, and he built it. He was a savvy businessman who always seemed to know just the right move to make and exactly when to make it. He created jobs for people in his community, many of whom came to his visitation last night and recalled to us fond memories of their time spent working for Mr. Ervin. Everyone said Mr. Ervin was the hardest worker they ever knew, and that is true. He worked very hard all his life. However, Rodney gave an interesting take on that aspect of his dad in a text to me yesterday. Rodney said he believes his dad never viewed getting stuff done as work. He loved accomplishing things and seeing the fruits of his labor. Rodney explained that he never heard his dad complain, a testament to how truly selfless Mr. Ervin was. After a long, hot summer in the fields, the approach of fall and the promise of another hunting season seemed to breathe new life into Mr. Ervin. You couldn't help but notice the glimmer in his eye and the renewed spring in his step. He was ready. Most evenings and Saturdays in October through December would find him in a stand, patiently waiting for the right buck to cross his path, and it usually didn't end well for the buck. His building walls were lined with trophies from past hunts, with a spot above the living room mantel reserved for the most impressive of his harvest. He shared his love of hunting with his sons, brothers, and many of his closest friends. Many great stories were born during these hunting trips, and Mr. Ervin had a gift for telling them. More than a few times I would sit, entranced, and listen to him tell one of his hunting stories, even if it was one I had heard before. He could make you feel like you were sitting in that stand right beside him. Although Mr. Ervin loved hunting in and of itself, I believe it was far more than just a hobby for him. I think he found at peace sitting in a deer stand that few other places could offer. It was a time he could reflect and be alone with his thoughts, a time to work things out, a time to be alone with God and enjoy his creation. As I come to the end of my thoughts, I'd like to focus on the one thing that was dearest to Mr. Ervin, his family. to the grandchildren. Papa had his own special relationship with each of you and a special place in his heart for each one of you. Remember the fun times that you shared with him and know that he loved you with all his heart. Scott, Rodney, and Christy, you are all amazing people in no small part because of the things your dad taught and instilled in you. I see the best parts of him in all of you. You are his legacy. Miss Edith, the love, respect, and devotion that you and Mr. Ervin share, for 56 years is a shining example of what we should all aspire to in marriage. We gather here today brokenhearted because someone that means so much to all of us has been taken away, and that wound will never completely heal. However, if we could see Mr. Ervin today, I don't think we would be grieving at all. Thanks to Jesus, death is not the end. It's just the beginning. And we have the promise of seeing him again someday. As Mr. Ervin would say, it was a good ride, and I find myself in a much better place at the end of it. But most of you know who I am, and I'll just introduce myself for those of you that do not. I am Pastor Scott Johnson. I pastor Stones Creek Haven Christian Church just up the street, one of our sister churches in Banner's Chapel here. And I've been honored and was asked to go and visit with Brother Ervin, and had some wonderful visits with the family. And I remember just a couple of years ago, going up to the hospital to visit Brother Ervin when he was there. And I'm thankful I was able to get to meet him. I've known some of the family for years, actually went to school with some of the family members. But you know, when I think about Brother Ervin, I think about the life of a farmer. You know, God made a farmer. We're going to talk about that today. God made a farmer. In Genesis chapter 2, verses 8 and also verses 15, we read that the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. Verse 15 says, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and to keep it. There's also a passage of scripture, a parable, that the Lord Jesus Christ spoke of concerning the sower. So we could also say that God himself was a farmer, and God created the farmer in Adam. God made a farmer. In fact, the very first man that was ever created, Adam, was a farmer. Paul Harvey said it best, and he said it this way: on the eighth day, God looked down on his planned paradise and said, I need a caretaker. So God made a farmer. He spoke of farmers as men who got up early and worked all day. They planted crops, they baled hay, worked on machinery, milked cows, cleared weeds and other debris and whatever else from the fields, among other things. And worked hard at raising crops and also providing for his family. And also, as Paul Harvey noted, if such a man was fortunate, he had neighbors who respected him and counted on him, and he also had a family who loved him. And he knew he loved him. And that was the description of Brother Ervin Dunn. He was a hard-working farmer, as has been described by Brother Timmy just a few moments ago. He was a hard-working farmer, a hard-working man who did much of what Paul Harvey actually described. He had many blessings in his life, and he spoke of those blessings constantly. He was not a complainer. He put his back to the grind, and he made things happen. He had many blessings in life that many men failed to attain. His neighbors, his friends, his community, and church family liked him and respected him. That right there goes a long way. He knew just about every farmer in the area. Most people knew who he was. Just a couple of days ago, I was over in the Coates area, and I come across a man that I had no idea he would know who Ervin Dunn is. And they asked me what my name was, and I told them, and they say, "Oh, I've seen your name in the obituaries." I said, "I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but you do a lot of funeral services, and I've seen your name." And they said, we know Brother Ervin Dunn. He was a fine man. He was a good man. I know he'll be missed. And so he was known throughout the communities, and he was well respected, not only as a farmer, but as a man of God. He was a father figure to many young farmers, some of those that are here today in this room, who would always lend a hand and be there when they needed him, ready to help anyone in the time of need. But more importantly, he had a family who knew just how much he loved them. They learned their work ethic from him and are honoring him now and will continue to by how they live their lives. There's no question the love that Miss Edith certainly and the children and all the rest of the family had for him. As I said a while ago, God made the first farmer in Adam. And people who are willing to admit it, and I hope that you are willing to admit it here today, know that farmers are the backbone of our society. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Someone put it this way: once in a while you need a doctor. Once in a while you need a lawyer. Once in a while you need a policeman or a paramedic. But every day, three times a day, you need a farmer. So God made a farmer. Amen. Now we know that Brother Ervin and Miss Edith had a bond and a love that can't be broken. Their love and dedication to one another was strong, and it was evident in the times that I visited with them. The devotion was so strong. And Miss Edith, I know that you're going to miss it. I'm not going to stand up here and lie and say the times are going to be easy or going to get any easier. We don't get through the loss of someone that we love so dearly. We just get through it the best way we can with the help of the good Lord. They had that kind of love that 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 8, and I'm not going to read that verse of scripture, but go and read it for yourself. That's the kind of love that they shared together, the right kind of love. 56 years of marriage here on earth, but at that great reunion one day in heaven when we see him, and you will see him again, this time it will be eternal. Never again to hear the word cancer. Never again to see him sick and suffering. I like to think about a farmer in heaven, and we know he loved his tractor. We know he's very comfortable on a tractor and comfortable working on a tractor, so I can imagine in heaven just seeing him on his favorite kind of tractor. And I like to believe and I like to trust in God that when we get to heaven one day and we're with him, things that we enjoyed here on earth, he's going to allow us to enjoy those things eternally. Amen? We just have to hold on to that. He loved to farm. He loved to see the fruits of his labor. He loved everyone around him and love to help anyone that he can. Scott, Rodney, and Christy, the children, there's also a bond and a love that also can't be broken. The love of a child. I can tell you that I only have one daughter. My wife and I were blessed with one daughter, and she was not able to have any more children after that. I have a daughter that's 31 years old. As a matter of fact, I didn't know Ervin and Edith back in those days, but my daughter and Hannah were actually in the Little Miss Benson pageant together many years ago. But my daughter is precious to me. And I'm not saying that Christy was more precious than the boys, but daughter-father relationship is pretty special. But he loved his children. And to his children, I want you to know that he was proud of each one of you for your accomplishments and where you are in life and where you're headed in your life. And he would say, carry on the legacy that he left behind for you to follow. And just know that he don't expect you to fill his shoes because they're big shoes to fill. He just expects you to follow in his footsteps, in his footprints. And to the grandchildren, I know this is hard on you. I know you loved him. And the great-grandchild, just know that he loved you and adored you. There was always a special place in his heart for each one of you. And you also live your life, fulfill your dreams in his honor, and do what he would want you to do. Having a granddaughter of my own, my daughter had a child on March the 24th, 2021, and having a 16-month-old grandbaby of my own, I know how special that relationship truly is. It's a relationship that cannot compare. To his siblings, Roy, Carolyn, Ira Lee, Ernie B., and Gene, I know you all have wonderful, wonderful memories and stories to tell. Some stories probably can't be told in church, amen, right? Don't ever let those memories die. Don't ever let those stories end. Always continue to tell those wonderful stories of times gone by. One of Brother Ervin's favorite quotes, I understand, was "Don't sweat the small stuff." Ain't that right, Miss Eve? I don't think Mr. Ervin, he was like me, he didn't like drama. And a lot of times we as pastors, we have to deal with a lot of drama sometimes. But when those things came forth and things had to be dealt with, that was his mindset. Don't sweat the small stuff. Deal with those things. Come together in love and deal with those things. Come up with a solution. But not a solution by our standards and by our wisdom, but by God's wisdom. That was his mindset. Now, we all know that there were hard times in his life. From the time he was 6 years old on to the day he died, he was a farmer pretty much. He was fostered at the age of six, and he started working on the farm at that time. Many times in his life, I'm sure he had ups and downs, but none other, no greater than his battle with cancer. But he fought it the best he could, all the while, with a heart of readiness. And his time on earth was drawing nigh. He knew that he was prepared and he was ready to meet his maker, the one that he had trusted in all those years. And you know, when I think about his time here on earth, serving the Lord Jesus Christ, I think of something that was told to me by Miss Edith just a few days ago. I think Scott, maybe one of the children, had put up some sheets over the windows and to make it a little bit more shade in there, a little bit darker in there so he could rest better. And he said that all of a sudden he just looked and he said, "Where's that light coming from?" She said, "What light?" He said, "There's a light coming." And she said, "Ervin, is it a beautiful light?" He said, "Yes, it's a beautiful light." You see, I've oftentimes told our people at our church at Stones Creek that if we could only see into the invisible world, the spiritual world, the angels that are surrounding us, we would all be amazed. I believe he was seeing something beautiful. He saw that light. But you know, he saw the light many years ago when he accepted Jesus as his personal Savior. He saw the light. His sins were forgiven. And he became a child of God. And like the Apostle Paul, he was ready. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Scripture says, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all of them also that love is appearing. It's two words, ready and prepared. Brother Ervin was ready, he was prepared for this day. You know, when I think about his time here at Banners Chapel Church, and of course, I haven't known Brother Ervin that long a period of time. But just hearing some of the stories from some of you guys and some of the church family and how much you loved him and how dear he was to all of you, I guess you could say he's been here 70 years, since he was 6 years old, I guess. Served in many capacities, as Brother Timmy said just a few moments ago. He loved his church and he loved the church family and would always stand upon the word of God, no matter what, in doing the right thing, especially when he served in a leadership role. But you know, there was other sides of Brother Ervin. Brother Ervin did like to hunt. I'm sure he liked to fish as well. I haven't heard any fishing stories, but I've heard the hunting story. I'm sure he liked to hunt and fish, and he had many that were along his side. And I can remember, before I even really knew Ervin, I can remember a Facebook picture of Ervin with that great big book, I think from Illinois, how proud he was of that thing. Maybe that was the last one that he killed. Love to be outdoors and hunt. I was listening to a story just before I come in today where Brother Gary Adams was sharing with me, and I'm not sure exactly who it was, but someone said that one time Brother Ervin was playing football with some friends and some fellows, and he told them that he was so tough that he could do a backwards flip and land on his feet. And they said that Brother Ervin, the daredevil, tried it, and he landed on his head and almost ended his life at that moment. Those are things, those are stories among other stories that we can hold on to. But the one thing that I want to bring out to you now is Brother Ervin Dunn. Of course we know he loved his family. But if Brother Ervin could speak to us today, I think he'd want us to understand his love for the Lord Jesus Christ. And he would want me to offer an opportunity and challenge you. If you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, he would challenge you today to make today the day of your salvation. We're not promised tomorrow. My goodness, we're not promised the next minute of our life. And how befitting it is that I hear the beautiful rain pouring outside. Another funny story. Went over to, I think it was Thursday evening. Y'all remember when the big rain came in Thursday evening? I was over at Brother Ervin's, and we were standing there, and I made the statement. I said, maybe Brother Ervin can put in a good word for his farmer friends and all of us here down here in the Meadow Benson community to send some showers of blessings and rain. And we prayed with him, and after we got through praying, all of a sudden, Christy, she looked outside, and we heard some noise, and she says, I believe it's raining. I said, Brother Ervin worked fast. He put in a good word for all of us, and I mean it rained. I left their house and I went home. I live in the Meadow community now, and I left and I went home, and it was pouring rain, and it rained all night, and it rained the next day. And there we hear the rain again, how befitting. You see, in God's time, God will shower us with his blessings if we just wait. God will also rescue us from our sins if we'll run to him, if we'll repent and make things right. John chapter 14. Verses 1 through 3, it says, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. In John chapter 14, verse 6, after hearing the doubting of Thomas of, we don't know the way. And how can we know the way, Lord? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father except through me. Jim Valvano, and as most of you here that know me well enough know that I am the opposite of an NC State fan. And I'll just leave it at that. But I had the opportunity to meet Jim Valvano many years ago. Jim Valvano, as most of you know, battled cancer. There's a foundation now that raises a lot of money for cancer research in his name, the Jimmy V Fund. But there's a quote that Jim Valvano stated that has always stuck with me, and I've used it at many services of those that have passed from cancer. And he made this statement. He said, quote, and I quote, "Cancer can take away my physical abilities. It cannot touch my mind. It cannot touch my heart. And it cannot touch my soul." Brother Ervin, because of his relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, can enjoy the beauties of heaven, can enjoy the beauties of glory, can enjoy the beauties of eternal life with Jesus because of promises made and promises kept. To the Banners Chapel Church family that are here today, I know you loved him and he loved you. He served here in many capacities, and I'm sure a lot of you served alongside of him. I want you to know that he loved you, each and every one, and loved his church. And I'm sure there were ups and downs through the years at times. But I've always been told that if you do the right thing, you honor God by honoring the Word of God and doing things the right way, God will always bless it. I'm sure Brother Ervin would say, may God's blessings continue to be on Baptist Chapel Church from this day forward. Now, I'm going to close with this. I know that I was blessed to hear the story from Miss Edith and the family. I didn't even realize this until she told me, but she said that every Sunday morning, Brother Ervin would watch Baptist Chapel services, and then he'd watch Stone Street services. And she made a statement that he said, "I don't care nothing about the music, just fast forward through that, I don't hear the preaching." And I'm so thankful that we were able to accommodate and be a blessing through our services, Brother Ervin, and our messages through Brother Ervin. And as I prayed with him, as Brother Timmy said just a few moments ago, Mr. Ervin, as I prayed my final prayer with him, as I was holding his hand that night when he was speaking, he held my hand, and after we got through, he said, "Thank you, sir." Very gently. "Thank you, sir." I knew and I felt it in my heart, this man is ready, this man is prepared. I didn't have to say anything else. So today, I found a poem that I would like to read. I thought it was very befitting before we play, have the benediction and have this closing song. The title of this poem, Miss Edith, is called "Close the Gate." And it says, "For this one farmer, the worries are over. Lie down and rest your head. Your time has been and struggles enough. Put the tractor in the shed. Yours were not easy, many downright hard, but your faith in God transcended. Put away your tools and sleep in peace. The fences have all been mended. You raised a fine family, worked the land well, and always followed the sun. Hang up your shovel inside of the barn. Your work here on earth is done. The faith you possess led your journey through life, often a jagged and stony way. The sun is setting, the cattle are all bedded, and here now is the end of your day. Your love of God's soul has passed on to your kin. The stories flow like fine wine. Wash off your work boots in the puddle left by blessed rain one final time. You always believed that the good Lord would provide, and he always had somehow. Take off your gloves and put them down. No more sweat and worry for you now. Your labor is done. Your home now is heaven. No more must you wait. Your legacy lives on, your love of the land, and we will close the gate." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we conclude the message part of this service, Lord, we are so thankful for the life that Brother Ervin Dunn lived here on earth. But Father, we rejoice in our hearts and know that he's going to enjoy an eternal state, an eternal life that will never end. There will be no more pain and suffering. There will be no more cancer. There will be no more hospitals or
funeral homes, there'll be no more hospice. Most of all, there'll be no more death. Father, we ask your blessings upon this family even now. Lord, that you will bless them in the times and the days and months and years to come. Lord, as they reflect back on wonderful memories of Brother Ervin, Lord, and tell the stories that will make them laugh and sometimes make them cry. But Lord, we know that the devil cannot steal that away. Father, I pray your blessings upon these friends and family, these farmer friends, Lord, that work side by side with Brother Ervin, and those that he was such a mentor to for so many years. Lord, I pray that you'll provide for them, Lord, continually. May they be successful in his honor. And Lord, I pray for this church and this church family. Lord, that they will move forward in their lives, Lord, and in Brother Ervin Dunn's honor, that they too will use that great motto, don't sweat the small stuff, but to put God first in all things that they do. And may he pour out his blessings upon this church moving forward. And many souls will be saved and many lives changed. In Jesus' name we pray.
Yeah. due to the weather outside, even though it's befitting for Mr. Ervin with the rain and the thunderstorms, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to travel to the gravesite for the committal. So the family has elected to do things in here. We'll have the committal service in here. Something very special was going to happen at the end of the service, and we still want that to take place. So if it's still raining at the end of the committal service, we're going to enjoy Brother Todd over here on the piano for a little bit. We're going to kind of wait the rain out so something special at the end can take place.
You got to laugh about this, right? Brother Merrill said, listen, you told me to tell him, I told him. Rain on my people. I was thinking about a passage of scripture. First of all, let me just say, as I would say if we were at the cemetery, let me say on behalf of the family, I would like to thank each and every one of you, first of all, for your attendance here today. And I'd like to thank you for whether it be food, visits, cards, phone calls, texts, whatever you did in support of this family, they thank you very much. Most of all, they thank you for your prayers and ask that you continue to pray for them during this time of loss. I was thinking about a passage of scripture that is the most comforting of anyone I can think of. That is the 23rd Psalm. It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither had entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Revelation chapter 21, verses 3 and 4 says, and I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. This time I've been asked to sing a song that I'm going to sing now that I would have been singing out in the cemetery. And it don't get any better than Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Mercy brings an ending love. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and push me as long as life endures. My chains are gone. God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone. God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine.
Most of you know Brother Ervin Dunn. He served his country in the National Guard for 6 years. And we're going to honor him at this time with the playing of taps. So I'm going to ask everyone if you would please stand for the playing of taps. You may be seated if you would like. I'm going to have a benediction prayer, and those of you that would like to hang out and wait it out, we're going to wait it out in here. And our brother Todd will be playing music inside the church here, so let us go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, as we have reached this final state of this service, Lord, we know that it's not the final destination for our lives. We're thankful, Father, for the life that Brother Ervin Dunn lived while here on earth. Father, more importantly, we're thankful for his relationship with you. And Lord, we're thankful for this beautiful family that he loved so dearly and that loved him so much. Father, we ask your blessings upon them now, Lord, and moving forward, that you'll surround them, Lord, with the comfort that they need, the strength that they need, the peace. Lord, we know that this is not an easy time for
for family. It's not an easy time for friends. It's not an easy time for church family. But Father, it's through you and by your strength that we can move forward and live our lives from this day forward. Lord, lead, guide, and direct. And may we give you the glory and honor and praise for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name.